Producing over 500 hours per week of talk radio, GCN Live is a world leader in talk radio. Archives for the following program can be found at GCNLive.com.
Live from the palatial studios at Emerson College in beautiful downtown Boston, this is the Jeff Santos Show on the Revolution Radio Network. Rebuilding America. Together, investing, activism, and supporting the middle class. Now, here's Jeff.
Oh, welcome to the Jeff Santos Show. I want to run too. We are 2 weeks away from New Hampshire, less than a week away from Iowa. It is the Jeff Santos Show. Welcome to it, everyone. Got a great show for you today. We're going to spend an entire hour on Flint, and I believe that this is going to be an important show, folks. One of the best, one of the most important ones, important shows we do, because to me this goes right to the heart of where we are in terms of understanding the need for the very simple needs of humans in this country of ours, of course, water, clean air. And this goes to the heart of, are we going to go down Republican corporate America, or are we going to go down a major change, not just tweaks, but a major change? We'll talk about that in a few minutes. Of course, welcome to the show. We got a lot of stuff to talk about on the Iowa Trail. We'll talk with Mark Taylor-Canfield, get his perspective from the West Coast at 3:30. At 4 o'clock, Marla Kilfoyle will step in and talk a little bit about how educators feel about this upcoming race and what Iowa, New Hampshire, and the early primary states mean to teachers' unions and to teachers and students across this country. Again, we'll spend the entire hour with Kurt Guyette, who has been the reporter from the ACLU, Michigan's ACLU, breaking this story. Our good friend Rachel Maddow having a big town hall tomorrow night. You know, used a lot of Kurt Guyette's stories to learn about this. She today credited, a lot of the local press on this issue. So we'll have Kurt Guyette for an entire hour, 4:30 to 5, and then 5 to 5:30. Robert Craig of Wisconsin Citizen Action will join in at 5:30 with us to get a perspective of what is happening to the Midwest of this country. 34 minutes past the hour to Jeff Santos Show. Before we get to our great friend Mark Taylor-Canfield, a shout out to a couple of people who are regular emailers of the show. Our good friend Steven in San Francisco Bay Area, and of course the lovable Elizabeth here in the South Shore of Massachusetts. Both of them have been big Bernie Sanders fans, and along with Rudy, who is a regular caller to the show, have been correct in their enthusiasm and their belief in the success of Bernie Sanders. There have been others as well, but I wanted to just mention those three. So Elizabeth, Rudy, and Stephen. Three different states. They all get it. There you go. All right. And I know that our next guest has also been an advocate for the likes of Bernie Sanders as well. He is, of course, a great freelance journalist. He is a regular here every Tuesday at 3:30 on the Jeff Santos Show. Our friend from the great state of Washington and the great city of Seattle, our good friend, Mr. Mark Taylor-Canfield, joins us. How you doing, Mark?
And now, live from Boston, it's the Jeff Santos Show. Hey, Jeff. Nice to talk to you again.
Nice to talk to you, my friend. Nice to talk to you. And I may have to use your voiceovers one of these days. And we will get to your opening music ready for next week, too. We've got lots to talk about, but I wanted to, again, focus here on what Bernie Sanders is trying to do and how, as we spend a good hour, next hour, on this whole issue of Flint, and the water crisis there, about good government and bad government. Now, we have seen, the great things, the increase in the minimum wage happening right there at SeaTac, first in the nation, system, that regional government system that would actually do that. We've seen a lot of other firsts from Washington. But we've also seen under a democratically controlled, legislature and governor, some things that have not gone done. How they obviously pay for public schools is one of the issues. And I wonder, Sanders has a lot of support. We all saw the 25,000. I think it was the first place where he actually ended up with over 20,000 was in Seattle. And I believe that Washington State is really on the cusp of doing some great things. I know as a rival, but as is the great state of California, and we've seen with Brown and Gavin Newsom and others what they've done. But I really believe that there is an understanding of how important government is. And I think that we have seen over 40 years now that the Republicans and some Democrats who have bought into this idea that government sucks and we have destroyed it, and we see what happened in Flint as just an example of this. Your thoughts from the West Coast?
Well, Jeff, we've got great examples of good government and also some examples of not so great government here. We've had, Jim McDermott is our congressional representative for many years, and he, as I've reported before, often gets elected with 80% of the vote. So he's very popular. It's a very progressive area in the Seattle, Puget Sound area. So he's been out front on things like single payer health care. We've also got a Democratic Socialist City Council member who was reelected last year with a very strong majority, Shama Sawant, and she's been out front on the $15 an hour minimum wage, which Seattle did adopt along with SeaTac Washington. She's also been talking a lot about rent control, and that's one of the issues that's really in gridlock in Washington State, is the fact that our state legislature has a statewide prohibition on any local forms of rent control. So there's an example of how government is not working for the people, because in a city like Seattle, where the rents are doubling, every month, it's not working for people. And that's why we have a civil emergency primary at Murray and our King County, Martin Luther King County commissioners, because of homelessness. So there's an example of some of the issues of why people in the Northwest and in the Seattle area have been so supportive of the Bernie Sanders campaign. There were over two dozen local meetups on the weekend for his national live stream address. And we can talk about this later, but I actually witnessed one of the volunteers, weeping during his speech because she was just so shocked that in this post-Citizens United era, you can actually get a campaign that seems to be as authentic as the Bernie Sanders campaign is. I mean, definitely the people up there on the stage behind him did not look like professional paid political consultants. They looked like, any folks you'd see walking down the street in Seattle. The girl in the tie-dye, I thought that was interesting. The fact that he had mostly women up there, which is a big issue too, the inequality in pay between men and women in the United States. Well, Seattle and the Puget Sound area have been out front on a lot of these issues, the legalization of marijuana, same-sex marriage, and there was even an attempt to label genetically modified organisms in food over the last couple of years. But we also have these other issues, which is a lack of funding for public education. Our state Supreme Court is suing the state legislature $100,000 a day for violating our own state constitution by failing to adequately fund the K-12 school programs. We've also got this huge issue with economic displacement. As the business a boom in Seattle happens, we have this other downside of, major corporate capitalism, and that is a lot of people are losing their places to live, and there are tent cities everywhere because people cannot afford the rents as the real estate prices go up and all these corporations move in. There's also a lack of funding, for social and health services as well, but affordable housing has been the big issue. And then also, Jeff, we have our version of the Big Dig here. We have Big Bertha. It's a major drilling project with the largest drilling machine in the world, which has broken down several times and has become a multi-billion dollar boondoggle. So there you go. We also have this issue with public works projects that are completely over budget than the taxpayers stuck with. We've also had a couple stadium issues that are like that. So at the same time that we've got some good examples of good government in this area, and a lot of, direct democracy in terms of all the caucuses and meetups that happen in Seattle on a almost daily basis, a lot of activism in this town, a lot of real strong connections between the progressive activists, the civil rights groups, the environmental groups, the church groups, religious groups. They're all sort of like tied in with our city council and our county commissioners. So there's a lot of direct communication going on there. And we had some activists running for city council. And one I should really mention is Lisa Herbold. She actually did win a very, very close election and is a new city council member in Seattle. She was a longtime legislative assistant to probably the most progressive city council member in the history of Seattle, and that is Nick Licata. So she is, he's retiring this year, along with Jim McDermott. So we've got two progressives that are bowing out, and we've got some new progressives that are stepping in.
You better replace them, because you can't just run around with another political stiff that gets elected because he or she has a lot of money, or will basically be on their knees begging for more money, which is usually the case. You talk about the whole issue of rent, and we've discussed a little bit of this because it's happening here where I live in Cambridge. Are there any political figures? You mentioned your progressive socialist city councilors. Do you have any hope that there are going to be some reforms to either bring back some kind of rent control or some kind of reduction in rent so middle class, working class Americans can do that?
Well, Seattle is quickly becoming a professional white collar software engineer biomed sort of town. And so, yes, the working folks and a lot of families, a lot of immigrant communities have been pushed out of their housing. I think that we are at such a crisis point with the civil emergency that's been called by the county and the city on the issue that, yes, our political representatives are finally starting to address that issue. And there has been some money that the city and the county has come up with from their emergency funds to deal with this issue, but there's a long way to go. And just like with the reform of the police department, there are local housing activists who think sector have not been adequate to deal with the issue. But I think we're at a point where even, maybe folks in Spokane aren't so worried about this issue. When it comes to the Puget Sound area, homelessness has become such an amazing economic disaster in the community that I think our state and local legislators and lawmakers are going to have to move on that issue now.
We're right back with our good friend Mark Taylor-Canfield. You're tuned in to the Jeff Santos Show. Back in a flash. 49 minutes past the hour. This is the Jeff Santos Show. A little Rolling Stones for you on this Tuesday. Just a couple of weeks before the New Hampshire primary. And, of course, we're down minus six days to the Iowa caucus and what that's going to mean. Bernie Sanders, as I said earlier, Mark, was really a big star early in Washington State. He made that trip across the West Coast, first starting in Wisconsin. Good friend John Nichols introducing him to, I think, over 10,000. And then he went to the West Coast, where he's been before, and over 20,000 people at one of the Seattle auditoriums there, or arenas. That, to me, opened the door, and I think later in Los Angeles, that this guy was for real. Talk to me about Sanders and the connection to those in Seattle.
Well, about a decade ago or more, actually, at this point, probably about a decade ago, Bernie was mayor of Burlington, Vermont, and he made a trip to Seattle at that time to talk about rent control, which was an issue that our city council person, Judy Nicastro, was pushing at that point. She was not successful, unfortunately, even though that was a major part of her campaign. But Bernie was here to talk about that at that time, so there was already a connection between our local city council and Bernie Sanders. And then Shama Sawant has also been our city council member, was one of the first to come out to endorse Bernie. And by the way, has not. She might actually be a possible candidate. She has not said that she's not going to run for Jim McDermott's position, by the way, so that could be an exciting race. But Bernie Sanders packed them in Seattle, just like Barack Obama did when he was running for president. He had huge crowds here. He has a lot of support in the Seattle area. And one of the things that I've been looking at, Jeff, is that I'm looking at this as from an international point of view, because I do a lot of reporting for Democracy Watch News, which covers pro-democracy movements around the world. That's our main specialty. And if you take a look at what's happening in the United States right now and you compare it to the Pierre Trudeau election in Canada and other democratic socialist movements that have been going on around the world, and especially in Europe, it looks like this is much less of a socialist movement. It's a pro-democracy movement in the United States, which, wow, shocking. You know, we need to fight for democracy in the United States. Well, yes, we do. Reporters Without Borders has ranked the United States as 49th in the world in terms of press freedom in 2015. And you have this whole agenda with the Bernie Sanders campaign that involves citizen participation, civil rights for all, including immigrants. And so it's an attempt to expand and renew the franchise. And that is a pro-democracy movement from my point of view.
I couldn't agree with you more. You know, Van Jones, who I respect a lot, one of the bright spots of the Obama administration early on, of course, talked last night about critiquing Bernie Sanders, but who was a supporter and has actually criticized Secretary Clinton going against him for health care. Van, who has been on the show a number of times early on, been a few years since we've had him on, but he was talking about the fact that we should talk about, and Sanders should talk about, the reforms that we had in this country, the civil rights movement of King, FDR's movement, and what we did really up until after Vietnam, after the protest that, of course, stopped the war, that was sort of the end of a lot of ways democracy. Now you have the Black Lives Matter movement and you have others that have propped up since. But that's what we're really doing. We're getting back to our roots, to the 20th century roots. You know, before that, Abraham Lincoln, sure. But I think that there really needs to be an understanding of that, and you're right. And the word socialism, tossed around, again, Bernie Sanders is not Fidel Castro. He's not Chavez. We're not looking to take over entire industries. And, you know, the more the people understand that, the more I think they'll go with him.
Yes, it's actually about being inclusive. He's very inclusive in his beliefs, and it appeals to a populist sentiment around the country. And there's a sense that we're all in this together, and that he said himself, whether you're left, right, middle, this elitism and prejudice and racism is tearing the country apart right now. So really, all people actually want is just to hear someone who speaks with their own voice about issues that the vast majority of politicians absolutely refuse to address. So during these Democratic national presidential debates, I have been amazed that some of the issues which actually directly affect the majority of the country's population on a daily basis are being addressed for the first time. And so already the Bernie Sanders campaign, the Black Lives Matter movement, is really pushed the agenda towards addressing issues that normally you're not going to hear during a presidential debate. There's always been criticisms by the journalists I work with about presidential debates, because, you know, when you go out into your community and you talk to people about what's affecting their lives, it's not what people are talking about during these debates. That is a national platform, a lot of economic and foreign policy issues. But when you talk to people in your own neighborhood who are not making enough money to pay their rent and who are having to move out of town, or who are living in their car even though they have two jobs, they're talking about basic daily economic issues that people are dealing
with. We seem to have lost the phone line of Mark Taylor-Canfield here on the Jeff Santos Show. Mark, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, we didn't catch the last 30 seconds of that. Well, you know, I look at what we are facing right now, and again, we'll spend a lot of time next hour with Kurt Guyette over the over on the issue of the Flint story. And to me, what we have seen in a good part of the Midwest, Michigan, now Illinois, Wisconsin with Walker, is a destruction of the democracy that we have taken for granted that we had. That was a staple of FDR and all the way through, including Republican Eisenhower, including to a certain extent even Nixon. And it's all been destroyed. And the Democrats that have taken power, like Bill Clinton, and even to a certain extent Barack Obama, have conceded that you can't win on the issues, so you become Republican light. And that's a sad state of affairs. And I'm really glad that we're now seeing a reopening, get back to that time period where America was indeed great. It's the Jeff Santos Show. Mr. Canfield, thank you, sir.
Always a pleasure, Jeff. I think you're right. The Democratic Party needs to get back to their roots, and they need to appeal to the grassroots in their party and the progressives if they're going to win this election.
We'll talk to you next Tuesday, my friend. All the best.
Take care, Jeff. See you guys next week.
Many of you know who listen to the show that I spent a lot of time with our friends in Chicago at the radio station there. And we miss our friends in Chicago. A lot of them, of course, still listen online. But I tell you, the heart of the Midwest, Illinois, Wisconsin, Michigan, these places, Ohio, where Nina Turner's from, they have all been inundated by slash-and-burn Republicans. Now, maybe Kasich is the best of the worst lot, but we hear about a issue, and Nina's going to be on the program tomorrow, about Sebring, Ohio, and the water crisis there, similar but smaller in scope, thankfully, to what's happened in Flint. And any time you, as Donald Trump, by the way, got to give him some credit, he basically, when Kasich went after Trump on a certain amount of issues, Kasich, Trump then sent to him, hey, the only reason why you're successful in balancing your budgets, of course, most of the states have it as a you have to do it, is because of fracking. All the money coming in Ohio from fracking. Of course, Pennsylvania, just to the east, knows all about that. So there you go, folks. That is what has happened. Now, in 2010, we'll go over this with Robert. In 2010, after a tough couple of years for President Obama and the transfer and the changeover and so forth, and, you know, Mickey Mouse work with leaning over to the Republicans, you ended up going into the 2010 election cycle with Democrats in control of the governorships in Pennsylvania, in Ohio, in Illinois, in Wisconsin, in Michigan, and all of them lost Republicans that year. And on top of it, the legislators followed with them so they could write the rules. Gerrymandering. So, it is really important when you're making your decision to vote for Secretary Clinton or Senator Sanders or Governor O'Malley. I thought all three of them were very good last night on CNN's town hall. Think about the idea of a massive change in how we get our message out, how we distinguish ourselves in a massive way, not just a little tweaking, and mainly on domestic issues. On the foreign policy side, it's pretty simple. Keep yourself out of war. You know, some guy got up last night and must have been orchestrated by the Clinton folks. It said you're going to have five things whether to go to war and five things if you don't want to go to war. Please. This should not be the discussion that we are having today. That's a Republican issue. And if Secretary Clinton wants to spend a good amount of her time talking about foreign policy. I'm commander-in-chief. I'm strong. I'm Popeye. All this other stuff. Fine. But the American people are concerned about what's happening in this country. Let's not rebuild Tripoli and Benghazi. Let's rebuild Tennessee and Boise. It's America knows that, and the people of Iowa know that, who are probably more than almost any part of the country less willing to go to war. Thom Hartmann, well known, was in Vietnam. Didn't want any part of this. He is advisor to her, but that's the point. What is at stake, folks, is that, as I've said before, and I wrote about it in the Huffington Post, the party, the progressive issues, will not go anywhere until we change the makeup of Congress and how people put pressure on Congress and moving the epicenter of politics out of Washington, D.C. And I say, oh, how are you going to do that, Jeff? Well, it's not that hard, particularly with the movement of social media today. We have seen time after time, I'll never forget, just back in 2012, I think it was during the Susan Komen Foundation, they were trying to do something in preventing some issues of being discussed. And I was in an Apple store with a couple of the Apple geniuses, one of them who was his wife, African-American kid, one of his wife was out there protesting this. And they changed it. And the Komen Foundation changed their policies within hours, 48 hours maybe. That's the power that we have today. Now, President Obama had this opportunity. And as Senator Sanders has said time and time again, and I know what President Obama said about Hillary, understood. You know, Obama came in as the anti-Washington person. He has now turned into a Washington insider. End of story. I loved him, gave him a lot of credit, still think he was a very good president. But he's an insider, and he's back of another insider in Hillary Clinton, even though he hasn't officially endorsed. Now, my view here is that you're going to need massive change, and one of the reasons why Sanders talks a lot about the political revolution. And maybe he needs to expand upon what that means. I think he does. I think he needs to have more moments talking about himself. I think he has to do a whole slew of things to begin to put a stamp on this revolution. I think he needs to bring in other people, as I've talked about before. And there are some good people in Washington, good people in the White House. Joe Biden would make a great Secretary of State. John Kerry, National Security Advisor. These are the folks that want less war and more peace. Now, are they totally fantastic on every issue on the foreign policy side, including trade? No. But if you isolate them to deal with peace and keep the peace, that is something that we can do. Now, there has to be other people that are reformers that are inside the Pentagon and inside the State Department and all the other aspects. But again, to me, if you were to connect with the people of this country and say, look, we need to take money from the military-industrial complex, from the military budget, $6 out of $10, and reduce that. Maybe it's going to be $4 out of $10. Still going to have the strongest military by far. But we need to rebuild the infrastructure. We need to pay for 4 years of public university. We need to pay for a single-payer health care system. And that's one of the ways we take it away. Hedge funds being taxed and Wall Street being taxed, all of that together. These are all things, again, as Sanders said last night, that Europe has been doing for years. 50, 60 years in some cases. And I believe that the United States, if it wasn't for Vietnam and the Reagan Revolution, then we would have been on the same path, because we were going there with Medicaid and Medicare, with the highway infrastructure under Eisenhower. The FDR New Deal was moving forward. Vietnam stopped it, took a whole bunch of money. We had the inflation and the bad economy of the late 70s, and then Reagan took over and slash and burn. And government is the problem, not the solution. We need to change that. And we need to change it fast. And more than Bernie have to be talking about it. It's the Jeff Santos Show, back in a flash.
Investing. Activism. This is the Jeff Santos Show.
23 minutes past the hour. It is the Jeff Santos Show. 844-3-SANTOS. Phone number to join us. Let's go to the phones, and it's time to talk to Rudy in the great city of Chicago. How you doing, Rude?
Okay, Jeff. I didn't see the CNN town hall last night, but I got a very good report on it from WCPT today. And they said that Bernie Sanders was as sharp as a tack, an excellent performance, and they wouldn't be surprised if this has sealed the nomination for him. So... that's what they said. You know, that's opinion.
right. No. I thought it was excellent. I think he needs to do more. I think he's got a long way to go before he can seal the nomination. But I tell you one thing that he did last night is that I think he spoke truth to power in what is going on with Secretary Clinton and Wall Street and her vote in Iraq. I thought that made the news. I also think, too, that his continuous alert to the American people on his on Secretary Clinton's, not being extremely truthful on all her votes and all of her decision-making, Keystone Pipeline, TPP, and so forth, is starting to come through, because that young gentleman asked a question about trustworthiness as the first question to Secretary Clinton. Now, some will consider it rude, but the fact is that that's been her record, and the polls show that, you know, majority of folks, you know, don't think she's trustworthy. She can blame it on all the other issues, but it is what it is.
Well, I think that's what this commentator meant when I heard him say that today.
Yeah.
There's 117 economists who agree with the position of Bernie Sanders, I'm told. And one of them was on Charlie Rose last night, Mohammed El Aryan. I've seen him several times, and saying that all the things Bernie Sanders is commenting on regarding the economy, inclusiveness in the economy, everybody should have a stake in the economy, and that the student loan situation is very dangerous, and he said we have to face these situations now, because it'll only get harder later on. And I think Bernie's been saying that all along.
Well, there's no doubt. Like I said, there's a long way between now and the nomination, and a long way between now and the presidency. But Bernie is the only guy running for president, and maybe the only guy in America that is willing to take on this amount of power in Wall Street, military-industrial complex, the media, everyone else, the Washington establishment. And that's why I think people are resonating to him, because they see David versus Goliath. And you know, they know that Goliath has done nothing for them over the last 30 years or more. So,
well, yeah, I that's right, absolutely. And I don't expect everyone to agree the way I think, but I've seen this in Bernie from the very beginning.
You have?
I guess I expect too much from the general public to see what I've been seeing. So, he's the only one. He's the only guy that's going to solve their problem.
Well, I think it's going to be important as the next couple of weeks go by. And if he wins in New Hampshire and wins in Iowa, then I want to see people, you know, like Elizabeth Warren and Jeff Merkley and, you know, a lot of other Democrats in Congress who are progressives, so-called 80 members of the Progressive Caucus, the two leaders, Ellison and Graal, they have endorsed already. I want to see people get behind because, again, as Bernie's talked about, he can't do it by himself. Other people have to get behind. And I think if he does these two states, people will understand that this is for real. And I think they will go ahead and move behind him.
No. Well, this opinion I heard is finally coming out from being neutral on you know, who supports who and who's got the right idea. And first, you know, it's one of the first coming out of a almost endorsement of Bernie Sanders. And, his handwriting's on the wall. It's so evident that I don't think anybody can refute that, you know, his position and who he is and that he's got the right idea.
Well, no doubt. We're going to talk a lot about the Midwest where you are in Illinois, my friend.
Yeah.
And stay tuned the rest of the show. Always great hearing from you, Rudy. Great points.
Okay.
And you are right, and you have been right since day one on Bernie. All the best, Rudy.
You too. Bye.
We're right back after this. Mark Taylor-Canfield on deck.